Sound design.
Intended placement examples. What are we doing here, Stephen?
All right. So I've been talking to quite a few folks about some of the wireless issues they've been having and just questions and concerns. And many of them have mentioned some advice on antenna placement.
Okay.
And really, there could be so many ways to express this and make diagrams. But I figure we'd pick, you know, maybe three examples that could really help us out. They're pretty general, but give you a good idea of just the baseline of where to put antennas.
Okay. So these are some common things that you have done wrong or you see other people do wrong. And we can kind of show here with graphics.
Both, yes. I have done them wrong, and I see it done wrong all the time.
Little column B. Okay, so my hope is that an infographic should be fairly self-explanatory. So if you have the patience for it, I would love to see what I already understand and then maybe ask questions about what I don't understand so far.
Yeah, let's go for it.
Okay, so I don't know what all these shapes are, but I know that these are two antennas, and the... The title here says IEMTX and mic RX. So I understand that to being in-ear monitor, transmitter, and microphone receiver. Is that correct so far?
Absolutely correct.
Okay. So what is this crazy looking antenna on the left here that's the IEM transmitter?
So that is a very common antenna type that we use for IEMs. It is called a helical. And that little spiral there you see is actually what is... It's basically shifting the wave to make something called, 360-degree polarization to create what's called circular polarization, which means that if we have a pack, and should have had this ready. There we go. If this is my in-ear pack, that means if I bend over and the antenna turns sideways or it's straight up, it doesn't matter. That antenna is basically shifting the wave 360 degrees to where it's going to reach it at any point. So we like these antennas a lot for in-ears because of that characteristic. Cool. Now, they also are high gain, which is important when you have just a tiny little antenna that's trying to get a lot of signal that's buried maybe under your skin. Signal is important. So we have circular polarization to hit the antenna at any direction, and we have a lot of forward gain to try and push through clothing and skin effect.
Okay. So the helical antenna makes it so that I can mount the receiver any way I want for the in-ear monitor, and it has lots of forward gain. And so I'm understanding from this big red X here and this big green check mark here that this here is wrong here on the left and this is right on the right, correct?
Yeah, absolutely. And so let's think about that for a second. So we mentioned a lot of forward gain, which means we have a lot of power coming from this guy. And so then we have to think about our microphones that are pretty sensitive because they're trying to pick up small signals from far away again. So if we take, and I have the helical here, something with a lot of power pointed in this direction going that way, and I put something here trying to pick up small power, we're going to overload this quite heavily.
Okay.
And that's going to cause a lot of problems.
And even though that antenna is directional and it's supposed to have a null behind it, it's still having some pickup. It's not no pickup.
Yeah, there is no such thing as an infinite null. Think about your 58 microphone with has, you know, a little bit of a null in the back. It still gets sound from the back, but not as much as from the front. So as much as we have a null in that back, we're still, when we're blasting with high-powered RF from behind, it's still going to be getting into that antenna.
Got it. Okay, so this is making sense to me. If I set these up, I should have the IM transmitter behind the receiver. So I shouldn't have the IM transmitter behind the receiver so that I don't blast my receiver with unwanted transmissions.
Yes.
Okay.
And some of you, and a lot of RF comes down to, some people might say, well, I've done it before and it worked. And it depends on a lot of things. You could have had your frequency band was far enough out where it's filtered. But again, we're always going to general practice because the minute one thing breaks in the system, that could be all it takes to just destroy your signal. So we want to just follow good practice from start to finish.
Cool. All right. So far this makes sense to me. So I can kind of remember this setup for the antennas. And it looks like since we're looking at the side here, and this is like a section view, we're just looking at these two-dimensional representation here of the antennas, then this maybe is the same thing down here in the middle, but a plan view from the top. So now I'm looking at something similar, but from the top. Is that correct?
Yeah. And so this is kind of what we're looking at here is we kind of want to get more than 6 feet away from any transmitting antenna. And something we're going to get into a little bit when we get to the bottom example of corporate AV is something called the reactive near field, which right around the antenna, we want to keep things away from it. But when we get farther away, what we're trying to do is just avoid the power coming out of that antenna. again, like we talked about the null, there is a null and there's a lot of direct forward direction that's very focused in a helical, but it's also radiating out the sides as well. So we want to keep transmitting antennas a minimum of 6. A lot of people say 10, but 6 you can get away with. And a lot of times there's, you know, you can say, I want this 20 feet that way, but in practical situations, that doesn't always happen. So I feel like 6 is a very good compromise. You'll be safe that way.
So Stephen, one thing I just noticed here in the middle, though, is that these LPDA shark fin antennas are not all the way behind the helical antenna like they are up here in the section view. So why aren't they pushed farther backwards like up here?
That's a very good point. And so the example we have up here is more for close proximity.
If they're not 6 feet apart.
Yes, if you have to be quite close together, that's kind of the way you want it. You want to have this RX antenna, the receive antenna, in the null. Now, if you have some room to spread out, which always, what we kept talking about, is a very good thing, then we can actually we can play around a little bit with it not being directly behind that, because you're far enough away to where, in a sense, you're almost using space to filter that out of the antenna.
So this is all good so far. So now what about this bottom part? This looks like the big red X is telling me antenna farm bad, having the receivers also close to each other, and we need to space them apart, and I'm guessing at least 6 inches, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Absolutely. And like I mentioned very briefly before, something called the reactive near field. So we have something called an antenna farm. A lot of people talk about antenna farms. So we have these antennas close to each other. Even if they're on the receive, once it starts getting energy and starts resonating, it can actually transfer some of the energy back and forth. So we lose that energy between different antennas. Now, if you have frequencies very close together, that could get some unwanted signal in this antenna that could cause interference. We're also losing some of that energy. So if we space it out about 6 inches, technically around 5 inches is the reactive near field of about 470 megahertz. So 6 inches, again, more is better, but because of constraints in an actual environment that we operate in, you can't have a corporate AV table with your microphone, with your receivers.
Sure. That's why we stack them up normally, exactly. Right? As we're trying to save space.
Because it saves space and it looks pretty, but it's not always the best for RF. So again, 6 inches, it's a compromise, but it should get you in a pretty safe area.
And the only way to not have to do this kind of spacing would be to have an antenna splitter, right? So then we could just have 2 antennas, a splitter, and those all go out to each of the receivers.
Yes, and that works well because there's isolation on each one of those ports. So everything, essentially you can put isolators on every antenna, but that becomes a whole other topic and quite expensive. But yes, so the other way to do this is with an antenna distro or a multi-coupler and 2 antennas.
Awesome. Well, this has been really helpful for me. This is something that I feel like I would print out and take with me, because although I understand it right now that we've had this conversation, I feel like I could pretty easily forget about this, in a couple of weeks when I might need to use it. So if you're watching right now and you have some questions about this, please comment below this video. If you have any other suggestions about antenna placement and how it's done best and how you do it, I would also love to hear those. My whole goal in doing this kind of stuff is not only for myself to learn more, but for us to sort of share all this information. So Stephen, thank you much. thank you so much for putting this together. And I think you're working on some more that we're going to be talking about in the future, right?
Absolutely. I'm quite excited about it. And I hope everyone watching this sticks in for that part as well.
Sound design. Live.